Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You know, the Lord is just, giving me that heart of worship. You know, praise God, since I first started, by the grace of God, you know, I've always been, you know, I just want to get to the Lord and touch the hem of his garment, you know. I mean, I want to be caught up to heaven. I want to be in the heaven with the Lord. I want to be caught up. You know, all these people that tell you, look, there are people probably that say, you know, they went to heaven and all that, and you know that they're fake. But there are people who are really caught up to heaven. Not only the Apostle Paul, not only John the Revelator. There's people, you know, God blesses his people. You know, he the Bible says if the ways are of your ways are pleasing to God, he'll give you the desires of your heart. You know, and that's the whole question is, you know, the Bible says, Paul said, to live is Christ and to die is gain. I'm trying to figure out how people who claim they're Christians, and you know that old, you know, this the old song, you know, this earth is not my home. I'm trying to figure out how come people want to go on in this world, why they want to be part of this world. This world is, you know, the things of this world are growing strangely dim in the light of his glorious grace. I mean, my home is a heavenly home, as I made it mention in the video the other day. I mean, I've got a passport, and the name of my passport is Jesus. Hallelujah. The name of my visa is Jesus. You know, that's why, you know, the song was in my spirit this morning. You know, I'm coming back to the heart of worship, you know, because it's all about you. You know, I just want to say this, you know, Michael W. Smith didn't write that song. He's famous for that song. There's much more anointed versions of that song. I don't, you know, nothing against Michael W. Smith. But there are people, as a matter of fact, I think I found a Korean church this morning who sing it's very anointed. As a matter of fact, by the grace of God, I might put the link on here if I have time. But anyway, brothers and sisters, you know, that old song, I guess it came in the late 90s. You know, it's, I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry for the things I've made it. You know, that's revival, coming back to the heart of worship. Brothers and sisters, there's many people that's never been to the heart of worship. They've been caught up in religion. They've been, you know, singing songs about me and about you, you know, about us, me, when we all get to heaven. You know, when the roll is caught up yonder, I'll be there. You know, Amazing Grace. And there's nothing wrong with that song. It's a classic that saved a wretch like me. You know, I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. And how many times can you say I? You know, there's no I in Jesus. Hallelujah. So the real way, you know, this is a question that I got in my spirit from the Lord. Do you want to go to heaven? Do you want to be in heaven? Well, guess what they're doing in heaven? They're worshiping the Lord. Have you ever read Revelation? They're standing around a throne singing, you know, worthy is the Lamb, you know, you know, to him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb be blessing and honor and power and glory forever. You know, all that time they call it, you know, the theologians call it the Hallelujah Choir. You know, they're praising the Lord, singing praises to his name, and hallelujah, and the angels are too. They're there giving glory to the Lord, and those four living creatures are going around the throne saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty who was and is to come. You know, blessed be the name of the Lord forevermore. He is worthy to be praised and adored. Blessed be his name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. That's a Don Moen song from the book of Revelation. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so the whole key is there's two types, really. I mean, you know, let's just get down to, you know, let's just break it down. You don't have to get in all this music stuff, but there's praise music and worship music. And the Bible says, I will enter. It says there's a song too about that. You know, a lot of the good anointed songs are Bible verses from the Psalms. And the Psalms were originally songs. They sang them as songs. The Lord himself, at the Last Supper, they sang some of the Psalms that go along with Passover. And there's the Ascension songs, going up to Jerusalem and all that. So we should sing the Ascension songs as we get ready to go in the rapture. You want to know what they are? Google that up there and you can see which ones they are. Anyway, so the Bible says, and the song is, you know, I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will be glad and, you know, I'll rejoice, for he has made me glad. So, I'm trying to say it without singing it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. That's an awesome song, and it's straight out of the book of Psalms. So we need to thank him and praise him. You know, you can use that as a formula of how you might pray to get your prayer started. But anyway, brothers and sisters, we praise him. We praise him. And the Bible says, Paul said in the Bible, I wish all men everywhere would lift up holy hands giving thanks to God. You know, so when these old denominational people, maybe yourself, you said, well, these people lifted hands. The Bible says that. I wish all men everywhere would lift holy hands to heaven. You know, praising God. That's what God wants us to do. We're giving him honor and praise. We're even saying, like, hey, pick me up, Daddy. Pick me up, Heavenly Father. Paul says that we can call God, that we're adopted. We call God Abba, Father, which is a nickname like Daddy is to Father. Jesus said we're supposed to pray our Father who art in heaven. So in the New Testament, we have a new covenant, and God is our Father. In the Old Testament, people keep talking about all these sacred names, you know, Yahweh and however you want to pronounce it, Yahweh, it's been lost. Those names, El Shaddai, El Elyon, Most High God, El Shaddai, God Almighty, all those names, you know, Jehovah Jireh or Yehovah Jireh, God is my provider, all those names are really the attributes of God. Those are man's revelation of who is God. You know, Moses, when his arms were lifted up for them to win the battle, whenever he lifted his arms, the army under Joshua would win, and whenever his arms would fall down, they would begin to lose. So Hur, his brother-in-law, and Aaron held up his arms, and you know, so that they could win the battle. And then it says that Moses called the place, you know, Yehovah Nisi, God is my banner. So this is revelations that man has gotten of God. But all of those things, as it says in Hebrews chapter 1, in sundry times or in old times, and all, you know, sundry, in sundry times, in old times, God spoke to us by various ways, but now he has spoken to us by his Son. So the manifestation of God is in its fullness in Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, in English, Jesus the Messiah, Jesus the Christ. It's the fullness of the Godhead dwelt bodily, the Bible tells us. It's all in all. That's why when that song says, you know, I'm coming back to the heart of worship, it's all about you, Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. When you make it about any other thing, if you make it about a clique in your church, if you make it about, you know, even, you know, which translation of the Bible people use, and even doctrines of the rapture or no rapture, all these things, you're making it about something that's secondary and a second-tier doctrine to Jesus. We don't have a religion, brothers and sisters. We don't have doctrines. That's why, you know, I know these things. I just had to put my finger on it, you know, to articulate it, maybe, until by the grace of God, by his Spirit today. You know, and there's people as always, you know, wanting to wrestle with me about doctrines. And some, you know, a lot of them have good intentions, you know, doctrines about, you know, the rapture, once saved, always saved, all these things. Those things are all this great to talk about. But brothers and sisters, our faith, someone said, well, that guy doesn't believe in the rapture. He's not a Christian. Or that guy believes in the rapture, so he's not a Christian. Or this guy believes in once saved, always saved, so he's not a Christian. This guy believes you can lose your salvation, he's not a Christian. That's not what, we don't have faith in doctrines. That's where you're getting, you know, that's what, you know, this Old Testament stuff's about. That's what all these other religions are about. There's a difference between biblical, evangelical Christianity and every other religion on the earth. And it's not doctrines. It is the person. You know, when Buddha died, he said, continue to search for the truth. His last words to his followers was, and Buddha, by the way, you know, he was an atheist. You know, he had a philosophy. Now they've turned him into a god. But Buddha said, you know, keep looking for the truth. Keep searching for the truth. You know, so our religion, if you want to call it religion, because religion means, you know, a system of, you know, even though for me religion is a bad word, but our religion is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And those same old denominational Pharisees are the very ones who keep saying that. Like, there's lots of them foreigners I've seen come to the Philippines, they keep saying, you know, and then, I've heard them speak, and they always say, you know, you need to have a personal relationship with Jesus. But then, instead of talking about Jesus and leading people to Jesus, they're leading people to their doctrine. This is our doctrine. You have to use King James 16:11. You know, and like I say, I love the King James. And if you're a native English speaker and you want to really get into the Word and, you know, you don't know Hebrew, go with it. When in doubt, go with the King James, because the other translations are from watered down texts that were found in the mid-1800s, which are probably not legitimate. The King James was translated from the Septuagint Scriptorium, which is probably the most accurate ancient manuscripts we have of the Bible. That's the reason why. The King James is the way to go. Go watch the documentary Tare Among Wheats by Chris Pinto here on YouTube as an example. You want to hear the truth about where these other you know, the manuscripts came from that made those modern translations. That's the problem. Not the modern translations themselves. It's the manuscripts that were alleged ancient manuscripts used to make them. Anyway, brothers and sisters, people going to the Philippines to remote areas where people, the average person might have went to the second grade and try to say, oh, you got to use the King James 1611 or you're going to hell. I mean, this is not developing people and leading people to Christ. This is leading people to your doctrines. Your doctrines, whether they be right or wrong, brothers and sisters. We lead people to a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, look, I've got 4 years of theological training, you know, at a real theological seminary university. Who cares? Other than the fact of keeping people out of false doctrine. That's the only thing I use it for, is to know where all the denominations come from and the Mormons and all that, and where they get the ideas, what Bible verses they use, and learn how to categorize these different trains of thought. You know, predestination, Calvinism, and all that, where it comes from, what Bible verses, how to categorize this stuff, and what is outside the bounds of the Word of God. Besides that, it's useless, other than to help people find the right, what the Bible's trying to say. But other than that, it's useless. John tells us in 1 John, you don't need nobody to teach you because the Holy Spirit himself will teach you. We've got the Holy Spirit to lead us into all truth and righteousness. That's what Jesus said. The problem with all these doctrinal people, they don't have the Holy Spirit. That's the problem. They're not being led by the Spirit. They're not being led by the Spirit. They're carnal-minded, flesh-minded. If Jesus walked into their church, he'd say, look at that hippie. He's wearing sandals and he's got long hair and a beard. That hippie's probably homeless. He doesn't fit in with us. He's not one of us. He's some kind of outsider. Let's make sure let's get the clique together here and shun him so he'll leave. So, you know, we can go back to preaching to the choir and say, I remember when I got saved. I got saved on November the 3rd, 1983, and praise God, I got saved. I got saved. I said a prayer one time, and I've been coming back here every week telling everybody I got saved. Same to the same group here. All of us keep repeating to each other that we got saved and our doctrine's right. Everybody else is wrong. All those other denominations and all those other doctrines are wrong. Our doctrines are the only ones that's right. And this is our doctrines and this is what we believe. Here, learn our doctrines. This is our statement of faith. It's what it's all about. It's all about statement of faith. I'm coming back to the heart of my Phariseeism because it's all about our doctrines. It's all about our doctrines. Come on, man. Come on. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. The Bible says in Amos 3:3, how could two walk together except they be in agreement? Now, this is what I ask those denominational people all the time. If I'm following Jesus and you're following Jesus, we should be walking together. And if we're not walking together, that means both of us or neither of us is following Jesus. One of us may be, or maybe both of us are not. But something's not right, because if we're brothers in Christ, we should be walking together. We should be in agreement to a certain point that we can love each other. You know, and as the Moravians quote that I've been quoting since I started my channel, the Moravians, they really founded the place where I'm from. People get Salem, Massachusetts, where the witches are mixed up with Winston-Salem, North Carolina, totally two different places. But they founded that, and they were one of the original Protestant groups and the first Protestant group to send out missionaries in all the world. And they had a great motto. And their motto was, in essentials, unity. In non-essentials, diversity. And in all things, love. That's the motto for Christianity. And it's not the same as ecumenicalism. It's not the same thing where they're trying, you know, Chrislam and all that kind of stuff. That's in the ditch. Of the statement I just made, that's in the ditch, because I said in essentials, unity. You know, the essentials of our faith, which is, you know, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father except by him. I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about the essential doctrines of what it means to be saved. We're not talking about that. I'm talking about all this other stuff, as I mentioned, King James only. Solemn worship, hymnal only, versus a modern-day praise and worship. Now, brothers and sisters, let me tell you something else. And I mentioned this in videos before. When the old hymnals came out, you know, and I read this before, and I don't have it with me, but I used to have it. In an English newspaper editorial, there's an article talking about all this modern music is from the devil. It's not from God. It's evil. It needs to not be allowed in the church. And these young people are going to hell with this music, and they're losing their godliness, and this music is not of God. And then the article was dated like 1820 something in the London editorial page of the London Times. And they were talking about hymnals, because hymnals were new at that time. Brothers and sisters, people automatically, old people always say, it used to be good in the old days. Everybody used to be holy and everything was great, and now everybody's going to hell in a handbasket. They always say that, even though in this last days, it is true that things are worse and they're going downhill. That's true. But they've always been saying that, when in actuality, God's been building up the church. The church has actually been being built up since the time of Martin Luther, since the time of the Reformation. We've been living in the last days. The Lord has been preparing the church to be in the fullness. You know, just as it says in Ecclesiastes, Solomon says, you know, as it was in the beginning, so shall it be in the end. So in the end, and so it is in the beginning, you know, and all that. So, really, Perry Stone did a lot of study and stuff about that, a lot of videos about that. The bottom line is that the church came to earth and in the fullness of the Holy Spirit and all that at Pentecost, and then the church will leave in that same state. Even the, and it's the same thing, the numbers of people. You know that the Bible says over 500 people saw Jesus after the resurrection at one time? It doesn't say how many people saw Jesus resurrected, but it says 500 at one time, Paul tells us. So there's, you know, maybe 1,000 people or more that saw Jesus resurrected. But in the upper room, brothers and sisters, there was only 120 people. Only 120 people. When we know at least 500 people saw the resurrected Christ, only 120. And brothers and sisters, many are called, but few are chosen, the Lord told us. And that's really true. You know, there's only a remnant. There's always been a remnant. The churches have been filled with tares and, you know, weeds. There's been weeds going through the garden of the Lord since the serpent was there. There's always been a remnant of God's real people. It's always been that way. Now, those old Pharisees, I know what they teach, like when I went to Bible college. You know, they teach that, oh, yeah, the people, they, you know, they get that mentality that, oh, there's only a few of us, but really, you know, that's a whole lot more universal. No, that's not true. I can tell you from 14 years experience in the ministry that it's true. Brothers and sisters, as an example, let me give you an anecdotal example. I used to really preach all over the place in the Philippines. I mean, two or three times a week, sometimes more than that. I mean, I preached to thousands and thousands of people all over the Philippines. I preached to lots of people in the States, too, but in the Philippines, I don't know what's the total. Maybe it's hundreds of thousands. I don't know. But I preach all over the place, and I would get up there and preach about how God wants to use you. The Philippines is only about 5% born-again Christian, brothers and sisters. And I would get up there and give a message that, you know, to the church about revival. God wants to use you. There's only a few Christians in the Philippines. God wants to use you to turn this country from 5% Christian to 90% Christian. You know, so then I would have an altar call, brothers and sisters, and I would say, and I've done this in America too, and it's the same result, basically. I would say, anybody that wants to be used by God, come down here. I'm going to lay hands on you, pray, and ask God to fill you with His Holy Spirit and use you to win this your country, the Philippines, to the Lord. And I would have altar call, brothers and sisters. Tons of people would come down there and ask to be prayed because their husband was alcoholic. They lost their job. There was sickness. And there's nothing wrong with those things. Pray for people to be healed. All that kind of stuff. I'm talking about in the church. I'm not talking about the problem with these old denominations, particularly Baptists, they have evangelism every week. If you have a group of Christians, you don't need to evangelize them every week. You do that if you have some non-believers there. If everybody's already saved, you don't need to do John 3:16 every week. And that's one of the biggest problems. There's no discipleship in these old dead denominations. They're preaching to the choir for 25 years, and there's nobody's been saved less than 25 years in the church, and they're still talking about, we're saved by grace. Thank God we're not like those people outside the walls. Thank God we're saved, and who cares about the outside world? Oh, just, you know, judgmental, self-righteous Pharisees. I can't say it enough because it's the truth. Anyway, I would have that altar call, brothers and sisters, and I love to pray for people for sickness and disease. I pray with lots of people that will heal. I don't know how many hundreds, but you know, it don't mean nothing. It don't mean nothing, brothers and sisters. God's the one doing it. What, as Jesus said, what good does it do, you know, to have two good eyes and go to hell? If your right eye offends you, pluck it out. It's better to enter heaven with one eye than go to hell with two eyes into hell fire. You know, oh, so what good does it do for the Lord to heal someone that's blind or heal someone that's crippled, and then they turn around and go to hell? I mean, this is just a temporal body. And of course, I believe in healing, and it's great But ultimately, it has no meaning. And there's too much emphasis on that, too, on the other end. That's not the point. The point is, brothers and sisters, when I would have that altar call, I would go to a church of 200 people. There maybe one person would say, I want to be used by the Lord. One person out of 200. Some churches, none. I would say half the churches, zero out of 100 people would come and say, yeah, I want to be used by God. You know, the whole thing I preached about, one person maybe, average of one person or less. Lots of times it was zero. I would say the average is probably 0.5. Half the time I would get one person. Now you imagine, same thing in America. People, they don't have the heart of Christ. You know, it's all about them. It's all about me. It's all about me. I got my ticket punched to heaven. I'm coming back to the heart of my own self. It's all about me. Talk about the prosperity gospel. People on one end, they're talking about people being blessed, at least not just only themselves, but other people can be blessed if you get, which is true. If you give, God will give unto you. But of course, they take it off into the ditch by making it, oh, God's going to give me a brand new gold-plated Mercedes-Benz to show that he's real. You know, they take it off the deep end. But these people on the other end, you know, it's all about them. I got my ticket punched to heaven. Hey, I'm cool. I know I'm saved. That's it. It's all about me. It's all about me. I'm coming back to the heart of myself because I got my ticket punched to go to heaven. That's it. They don't, no care, no concern, no worry about anybody else but themselves. Brothers and sisters, these things ought not be. This is not the heart of Christ. This is not the mind of Christ. The Bible says if you're a Christian, you have the mind of Christ. You have the heart of Christ. The Bible says that God wants to conform us to the image of Christ. Now, what did Jesus do? The Bible says he is an apostle. Jesus is an apostle. You didn't know that? Well, you got to read your Bible. It says in Hebrews that Jesus is an apostle. What does that mean? An apostle is a sent one. Jesus came to earth for one purpose, to give the good news that he is the Christ. He's the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except by him, and to set his face like flint to go up Calvary's hill and die a death in our place. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. It says he himself bore our sicknesses and diseases. He took upon himself our sin on the cross, the Bible says. He took our sin. He took our sickness. He took our diseases. He took our punishment. You know, he died in our place. We're supposed to be on the cross, but Jesus chose to take our punishment. That's what it's all about. That's the good news. I don't have to die because Jesus died for me. He died for you. That's the good news. Jesus took our place. He didn't deserve to die. I do deserve to die. I deserve to be punished for my sin. You deserve to be punished for your sin. But God made a way, one way, and one truth, and one life. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the heart of our religion. You can't over-exalt Jesus. He is God. He is God. The Bible says that the fullness of the Godhead dwelled in him bodily. He is the exact expressed image of God, the Bible says. Jesus is God. You can't over-exalt him and over-worship him. A personal relationship with Jesus is being a Christian, to follow Jesus. Follow him. If you were following Jesus, you wouldn't be worried about all those things. You wouldn't be worried about what's going on in this world. You would be saying, you know, Jesus is moving. I better keep moving. Jesus is not standing still. When Jesus came to earth, he wasn't just hanging out. He was going and telling the good news. He was going and healing and doing and feeding the 5,000, multiplying and giving and teaching and leading his church. The Lord is still leading his church. You know why these churches aren't going anywhere? Because the head of their church is not Jesus. The head of their church is the Pope, or their bishop, or their denominational board, or their board of elders, or their, God forbid, those old, you know, the deacons. That's the biggest problem, you know, here in the Bible Belt. You know, the mascot of Wake Forest University is the Demon Deacons. What better name could you think of? The Demon Deacons, trying to control and dictate what the pastor's doing and not let the pastor follow Jesus, as Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. The pastor of a church is supposed to say to his people, the congregation that God allowed him to be the under-pastor for, the assistant pastor to Jesus, follow me as I follow Christ. But instead, 99% of the churches that I've ever had any contact with, they're building their own kingdom. Either the pastor is a cult of personality, like a lot of these guys you see on TV, or the church is ran and controlled by the demon deacons or by the elders, like these mega churches. The one that I went to as an altar worker while I was going to Bible school, the biggest Assemblies of God church there in Winston-Salem, First Assemblies of God. They've changed their name to some name that doesn't even say church anymore, because now they're really totally gone off the deep end. But instead, their whole goal every week was, how can we make this church bigger? They had all these business models. They had business people and politicians, local politicians and business people up there with chalkboards. You know, I was on the altar team, and they had these meetings, and they were using all these business terms, you know, about, you know, our product is here, and we're doing this and doing that. All this business lingo, synergy and paradigm, they were using all those big, cool words. All of this, you know, the latest, you know, junk that when you don't really know what to say, you start throwing out those words, synergy and paradigm. All about building their own kingdom. That's the problem across the board of the whole church. People building their own kingdom and not the Lord's kingdom. Brothers and sisters, we the remnant, and I praise God, you know, thank the Lord for YouTube, thank the Lord for the internet. We can individually, you know, have video on demand. And we can go where, you know, the Lord leads us, listen to the worship music we want to listen to, whether it be Southern gospel or praise and worship or modern day worship music, whatever you want to listen to, you can find it. You can listen to the preaching. That's the style of preaching that you like, whether you want people to keep, you know, Joel Osteen to keep grinning at you, you know, and loving you with that old lovey-dovey all the way to hell, or somebody that's going to preach you the word straight up without pulling any punches. Praise God. Praise God, you know, that the people that want to really follow the Lord can find each other through the internet. Thank God that's a blessing. Well, but all the bad parts about the internet, at least we have that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. You know, the thing that we can do, brothers and sisters, is we have to follow Jesus. I'm just asking people that watch my videos, you know, the Lord has just been, you know, really speaking to me that, he's going to do something. Of course, it's time for the rapture. We know that. But the Lord's going to do something. You know, he's really going to do something. And, you know, and maybe it's the rapture. Like I say, I'm not sure. Or he's going to send revival on his remnant. And like I say, I've been very pessimistic about revival coming because everything's so far gone. We're so close to the rapture. And I still believe that. But that doesn't mean he won't send a revival on his people. You know, some kind of a quick work that he might do. It might even only be days or weeks. I have no idea. I have no idea, brothers and sisters. We can only, you know, I only know what the Lord's, you know, leading me and showing me. And I'm just telling you that the Lord, you know, the Lord is with us. He's with those who are his followers. The Lord, you know, if God be for you, who can be against you, you know? The Lord is the one to lift us up out of the miry clay. He's the one that saved us, you know? Like the song, you know, Victory in Jesus. That's an old, Baptist hymnal song. You know, he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. You know, he loved me ere I knew him, and all my love goes to him. He brought me to victory with his, I'm getting all the words mixed up, with, I haven't heard it in a long time, with his redeeming blood. Anyway, he sought me and he bought me, right? He got you, he sought us, just like Jesus told his disciples, you know, he told them, you know, follow me. And then later on at the end of the Gospel of John, he said, you know that you didn't choose me, I chose you. Jesus chose us, he chose you and me. Many are called, but few are chosen. Hey, you know, people, you know, there's people out there, and I hear them say that, you know, it's like, you know, they'll quote the Bible verse, God is not a respecter of persons. Yeah, anybody that will come to him can get saved. But God does call people out and choose people. Not everybody's called to be an evangelist. Not everyone's called to, you know, the office of an evangelist, the officer of a pastor. Not everybody's called to make YouTube videos. Not everybody's called to lay hands on people and pray and all those things. And thank God, if God used you for any of those things, thank God for it. You know, because he's going to be the one to anoint you to do it. He's going to be the one to provide everything, the time, the energy, the finances, everything you need to do it. He's going to be the one to reward you for it, to say, well done, my good and faithful servant. You know, the Lord's got it all laid out. When he asks you to do something, he's asking you because he wants you to do that thing to bless somebody else or whatever it is he's trying to get you to do. But he's also setting you up because he's going to bless you. He's going to reward you. He's going to honor you in eternity for the things that you do. And sometimes even in this life, you know, there's one text where Peter says, well, you know, Lord, we've given up everything for you. What about us? You know, we've given up everything. And Jesus said, whoever gives up houses and sisters and brothers and mothers and families and all these things for me, we'll be rewarded in a hundredfold, he says, in this life and in the life to come, with tribulation, with tribulation, brothers and sisters. That's the part that people don't want. People don't want no tribulation, you know, not the tribulation. I'm talking about, you know, those people that don't believe in the rapture, they'll take that text and say, oh, that means we got the tribulation. It's tribulation in your life, troubles in your life, people giving you a hard time, people harassing you, people feeding you to the lions like they did the Christians in the early church in Rome. All those things. You have tribulations. People's going to give you a hard time. The world hates us. Jesus, you know, that's like I say, that's the problem with Joel Osteen and those guys. The world loves them. Jesus said, no servant is above his master. You know, they hated me, they hate you also. You have to accept that fact. If you're walking and being a Christian, salt and light, there's people that ain't going to like it. But that don't mean you got to go out here picking a fight and being a sourpuss and being, you know, a jerk and stuff like that. Either, you know, there's a balance. You can't be Joel Osteen, but you can't be, you know, like a... You know, you can't be an old vinegar either, you know. And that's the problem I had with old David Wilkerson. Now, he's dead now. You know, I have nothing against his teaching. But if you watch David Wilkerson, he's a very negative person. You know, he's very vinegar. He comes across as having no joy or peace or nothing in his life. So, you know, you got to have a balance. I mean, there's other ones. You know, that's just one I mentioned is the easiest one I could think of. You have to have a balance. You know, you can have righteous indignation, but it's got to be in love. You know, so that's where a balance comes in, brothers and sisters. Anyway, God bless you guys. Love all you guys. And I beg you, please don't major in the minors of the stuff I said in the video. Please don't major in the minors. Oh, little details. And when I say that, I mean like I made a mention the other day of a video of a worldly song that's from Ecclesiastes, you know, where it says, to everything, turn. And I said the Yardbirds. And then someone told me, oh, it was the birds. Well, you know, I thought I got those two mixed up because, you know, it's before my time. I always get the Yardbirds and the birds mixed up. But you know what? It has zero to do with the message I gave. My message was about that text from the Bible that was made into a song. Lots of people know it as a song, but they didn't know it came from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 10 and 11 along in there. But that's where it came from. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. Love you guys. Remember that the heart of our religion is to be a disciple of Jesus, a follower of Jesus. It's Jesus, a personal relationship with Jesus. You know, and all these people that are doing all this, that's the thing about it. They're blinded. They don't know it. When you're all of this, you know, all this nitpicky stuff that people are doing and it's not in love, you know, and just looking and everybody, you know, checking off, you know, and checking off people. I don't like this person because they said one thing I don't agree with. Boom, they're a false prophet, this, that, and the other. That's not in the heart of Christ. You are in the flesh, you're carnal-minded, and you're a Pharisee. You need to repent, and you need to get, and there's a balance of having the love of Christ. I mean, like I said, it's a balance. Joel Osteen is just taking it to an extreme, but the idea of being loving to people, that's the right idea. That's the right idea. And that's our number one thing that we're to do. A greatest of all things is love. In the Bible, it says it. Now about faith, hope, and charity. Charity is agape love, sacrificial, God-like love, giving love. And the greatest of these is love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, Paul said, you know, I can do all these mighty things and all these great works of God, but without love, I'm nothing. Without agape, I am nothing. Brothers and sisters, without love, you don't have nothing. And the heart of God is to love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. For God so agape the world that he gave his only begotten Son. God wishes none to perish, but all to come to repentance. Brothers and sisters, get the heart of Christ, which is love and compassion. But yet, you have to speak the truth in love. God bless you guys. Love you guys, as I said. And, you know, may God bring reconciliation to all the children of the Lord. May all of God's children, Christians, who are born-again Christians, not all these cults. Of course, that's where we have to have discernment. I'm talking about like Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses, all these cults, false religions, Roman Catholicism teachings, worshiping Mary and all that stuff. And you don't need, and the Pope just said it was dangerous to try to have a personal relationship with Jesus. That's not part of Christianity. I'm talking about biblical Christianity, that we can have in essentials unity, non-essentials diversity, and in all things love. God bless you guys.